Hey everybody, this is Russ from Metro Game Core. Today we are going to review this handheld. It is called the KTR1, and whether or not you've heard of this really depends on how involved you are in the whole retro handheld thing. Because this little guy has been in the works for years at this point. It's developed by just one person, and so it's existed a lot on the forums and things like that, but chances are if you're really just kind of getting into it, you may not have heard of it. Now, one of the great things about this device is that it's made by a retro handheld fan for other retro handheld users, and so there's a lot of customizability. For example, you have the ability to choose whether or not you want the D-pad or the analog stick on top when you order it, and you have a variety of colors to choose from, plus you can choose whether or not you wanted to have it in plastic or in metal. Not only that, we have a powerful processor inside, plus a 3:2 aspect ratio screen, which is going to be really good for retro gaming, and it's at a 1080p resolution. So as you can imagine, all of the parts are kind of falling into place with this one handheld here, and so in this video, we're going to pick it apart and see exactly what it can do. Now, just in the interest of disclosure here, this is a review unit that was sent over to me. It's not a final release build. They're working on their first batch of 1,000 units right now, and those should start shipping here in the next couple weeks. And so I know there are a lot of people who have already pre-ordered who are interested in finding out what the experience is going to be like, but there's probably a lot out there too wondering whether or not this is going to be a good match for them as a purchase. So we're going to cover all those things in this video here. It's probably going to be a long one, so make sure you grab a drink and your favorite snack. And without any further delay, let's jump into it. Okay, let's get started on the specs. The KTR1 has a MediaTek Helio G99 chipset, and this has an 8-core CPU. Now the RAM is LPDDR4, and there are three different spec options. We'll talk about that here in a second. Along those same lines, you have three different sizes for internal storage. Now, probably the most unique aspect of this device is the display. It is 4.5 inches with a 1080p resolution, but with a 3:2 aspect ratio. And I've talked about this aspect ratio a lot in the fact that it works really well for both widescreen and 4:3 content. And I also think that 4.5 inches is like the perfect size for a smallish handheld. And so really, in terms of displays, we're looking at something that is very close to a perfect storm. This also has one of the largest batteries that you can find in a device this size. At 7,000 milliamp hours, I would expect about 10 hours of gameplay easily. And depending on which model you get, you could have either 18 or 35 watts of fast charging too. In terms of other features, we have Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth 5.2. And if you want to add your own SIM card, there is a 4G option available as well. And then finally, this is an Android-based device. It's running Android 12. Now the pre-sale price is $169 before shipping right now. And that is for the lowest spec model with 4 gigs of RAM and 64 gigs of internal storage. However, you can also see that the developer recommends getting the higher RAM versions if you want to play something like PS2. And each of these levels will go up $30 each, all the way to $229 for the full spec model. There are also 7 different color options, but it looks like the availability on this can vary. So right now they have a white or cream color, and then yellow, red, and gray. Personally, among all of these, I think the yellow one or maybe the red one look the best to me. Now, one of my favorite things about this device is that it's configurable. For example, if you want the joystick up top, you can select that or the D-pad as well. The way I see it, if you're going to be playing mostly retro games, then I think the D-pad should be up on top, but if you're going to be playing something like Nintendo 64 and beyond, then I think the joystick on top makes more sense. You also have the choice of either a plastic or a metal shell. And bear in mind that if you get the metal version, it will increase the price by about 50 bucks. And it looks like if you get the metal version, you're going to be stuck with the Wi-Fi only model. So if you do want 4G connectivity, you'll have to stick with the plastic model. So depending on your configuration, you should be able to get this device for under $200 all the way up to a little bit under $300. Either way, let's go ahead and take a look at my review unit. And as a reminder, this is an early development unit. That means there may be some changes in the build quality when you get to mass production. Either way, as you can see, it's a pretty simple design overall, very reminiscent of other retro handhelds available on the market. And as you can see, mine came with the joystick up, and that's actually something I requested from the developer. And so let's go ahead and move into testing out these controls. We'll start with the analog stick first. Now this is a Nintendo Switch style Joy-Con, and it feels to me like they're using the exact same Hall sensor sticks that are available on a couple AmberNIC devices. And I really like these sticks. I like the cap that they have on top. It just has a nice gritty feel to it. And of course, while these Joy-Con sticks are not the most elegant in the world, they are relatively low form factor and easy to pocket. And they feel just fine. They have a full range of motion right here and feel nice and smooth. Now, when actually testing the joysticks within the Game Tester app, I did find that there was basically no dead zone with these sticks, but then also I found that they did not snap to the linear cardinal points. So we are getting a full range of motion within the dead zones. However, at the very edges, you can see it's only giving a circular input. What this means is at the very corners, you're not going to get a 100% signal. And that can cause issues when playing a game that requires a 3D analog input. Now, this is something that a lot of other manufacturers have gotten wrong before, and so hopefully this can be a software fix in the future. Now let's take a look at the D-pad. This has a rubber membrane connection right here and is a little bit on the small side. I think in terms of the button feel and travel, it is pretty good, but I would say that the rubber membrane's a little bit stiffer than I would like. I feel like I have to mash down pretty hard to get a full input. It also feels like the pivot here is a little bit on the shallow side, in the sense that I can push down the entire D-pad pretty far, and then when I try to roll it around, I'm not seeing a lot of action here. Now let's actually test the D-pad using the Contra test. Here what I'm going to do is press down on the D-pad and then try to rock it left and right. And if the character moves a bunch, then that means that you can expect accidental diagonals. But as you can see here, the character is staying relatively still. And so when it comes to playing a platform game where you don't want to press a diagonal like in Contra, then I think this will work out pretty well. And of course, just as a quick test here in gameplay, if I want to press a diagonal, that's also pretty easy to do. So I think when it comes to playing platformers, especially those that require precision input, you should be good to go here. Yes, the membrane still feels a little bit stiffer than I would like, but at least for these games, I didn't find it to be an obstruction. However, when it came to fighting games, I did find that I had a tougher time doing the diagonal moves than I would expect. And that makes sense because it is kind of hard to roll into a diagonal. I found in particular when playing Capcom fighting games, I could do like fireball moves and usually I could get that okay. But when trying to do a dragon punch or a shoryuken, yeah, I didn't really have that much success. So if anything, I would say that this is probably not going to be the best handheld in the world when it comes to playing these classic fighting games with a D-pad. At the very least, I would say it's hadoukenable, but not consistently shoryukenable. Also on the left side near the bottom here, we have one of our two stereo speakers. And we'll test those out later in the video. On the right side, we have another analog stick and speaker, very similar to how it was on the left. And then we have our four face buttons, and these have an A, B, and X, Y pattern, similar to an Xbox. Now these buttons are a little bit on the small side, and I also found that they don't stick out as much as I would like, and the travel here also gets very close to bottoming out against the case. And to me, I prefer to have the buttons stick out a little bit more than this. Additionally, the rubber membrane underneath feels just about as stiff as the D-pad too. And again, I would argue that this is a little bit too stiff. It kind of has a thunky quality to it altogether. I feel like I'm using too much force to press down on the button, and then I also don't like the fact that it's basically bottoming out. If I had to compare this stiff membrane to other consoles, I say it's pretty similar to the Retroid Pocket 2 Plus, as well as the AYN Odin. And so if you tried either of those devices and you didn't like how hard it was to press down on the buttons, you're going to have a similar experience here. Ideally, I would like these buttons to be a little bit taller in the shell, but then also when you press down on them that they have a little bit of height left too. That, I think, coupled with a less stiff membrane would give you a much better experience. And I think in that regard, Ambronic devices like the RG552 right here are a little bit better feeling. And again, this might change when it goes into mass production, but at least here on this test unit, I was not very impressed by these face buttons. Now we also have four different function buttons here on the front. And these each will serve a different purpose. The bottom ones here are basically going to be your start and select, and then the one on the top right will function as your home button within Android. And I have to say that the placement of this button here just drove me nuts. As you can probably imagine, this thing is so close to the other face buttons that sometimes I would accidentally press it. And anytime you press the home button within RetroArch, it will completely kill the app. So that means it's going to take you right out of your game and it won't do any auto-saving either. And I found it very frustrating to lose progress on my game just like that. In addition, because it's up here on the top, there were many times where I accidentally pressed it because I thought it was the start button. Now of course, we can always just blame my brain when it comes to that because essentially I'm treating it like a Nintendo Switch. But all the same, after pressing it about 20 or 30 times on accident, man, it really drove me up the wall. When it comes down to it, I don't have a huge deal with the fact that they have a button up here. I just kind of hate the fact that when I do press on that, it has very consequential actions. Now the one on the left is completely mappable. You can basically turn this into any other function key if you'd like. And so, for example, within RetroArch, I would use this as my hotkey enable button. So if I wanted to exit a game, I would press the hotkey up here on the left and then the start button here on the bottom right. But again, there were many times when I would accidentally press the home button instead and then kill the app altogether. Again, that was a pretty frustrating experience. And these buttons are even worse than the face buttons when it comes to bottoming out. In fact, you have to press them all the way down and even a little bit more into the shell just to get them to register in the first place. So much like with the face buttons, I hope that these are a little bit taller in the final build, because the fact that they bottom out like this does not feel very good. Okay, now let's take a look at up top. Now we have these inline shoulders and triggers right here, and these have a very clicky and micro-switchy feel to them. And as far as buttons go, I would say they are functional, but all the same, they remind me a lot of an older handheld. These are the kind of buttons that we saw in something like the old Ambernic RG351P released in 2020. And with my test unit, these were pretty loose buttons too. In fact, they rattled quite a lot. Let's have a listen right here. Now, there are still manufacturers who are making inline shoulder buttons. For example, Ambernic has this with their most recent device, the RG405M. But they've developed this new kind of scissor switch style right here, which is a lot easier to use, and it feels a lot more solid too. Let's do a quick shake test so you can hear the difference. So I guess in the end, yes, I wish there were stacked shoulder buttons right here because I think it would make it a lot easier to play things like game streaming. And overall, these buttons do feel quite cheap. Looking at the rest of the top here, we have our power button as well as our volume up and down. And with this handheld, they put the volume up button on the left instead of the right. And this will happen on some retro handhelds from time to time, but I've always found it a little bit weird. We also have these little holes right here, which I think is for a mic input. And then we have a passive exhaust vent right here. Looking at the bottom, we have another one of those mic holes and then a USB-C charging port, which is sadly not capable of video out. And then finally, we have our headphone jack, as well as our micro SD card slot, which can come with a SIM card slot if you have the upgrade. Now, looking at the back here, you can see it's basically unadorned. I'm not sure if they're going to put more things on the retail unit, but you can also see that the plastic material that they're using does get smudgy over time. So if anything, I would recommend not getting the black model if you don't like smudges like this. And the smudging will also show up on the front and sides of the device like this as well. Overall, I have some mixed feelings about the hardware when it comes to the buttons and ergonomics. I do think that the buttons are easy to access, but I also think that the triggers would have been better served if they were stacked. And while I think that the D-pad and joysticks are pretty good on this device overall, I'm really not a fan of these face buttons as well as those function buttons. Now, even though this is a test development build, I was still curious, and so I did a quick teardown right here. To start, you can see this definitely has a homemade feel to it overall, but I think a lot of things here were done pretty smartly. For example, we have a pretty large copper heatsink right here, and you can see that the battery is oriented as far away from the CPU as it can be. Now, one thing I was looking for are the rumble motors, because this does have built-in rumble, but I think it might be on the other side of the PCB because it wasn't apparent to me, at least right here. Either way, yes, this is what it looks like inside, and it's probably going to be different with the final build. So next up, let's go ahead and do some screen testing. I'm going to start with the Ambernic RG405M. This is a 4-inch 4x3 display. And as you can see here, when displaying 4x3 content, both of these actually show about 4 inches of screen real estate altogether. And so even though the KTR1 has a 4.5-inch screen, when showing 4x3 content, it's basically the same as the 405M. So if anything, I think that's more impressive about the 405M in the fact that it's a smaller device with the same size screen with this type of content. However, when you try to play something like Game Boy Advance, you can see that the size difference is quite significant. Obviously, the KTR1 is going to give you the full 4.5 inches, but the RG405M is a little bit shy of 4 inches. So you are getting over a half inch difference between the two by virtue of the 3:2 aspect ratio screen on the KTR1. So if you're really into Game Boy Advance games, I think that this one up above is going to be a better fit. Now, when comparing it to 3.5-inch screens, for example, the RG353M, you can see the size difference between the two is night and day. So if you've ever felt like a 3.5-inch screen, for example, on one of these or the Retroid Pocket 2 Plus, is just a little bit too squinty, then I would say the KTR1 and even the RG405M are going to give you a larger experience. And as you can imagine, the difference is even more stark when we look at 3:2 content like Game Boy Advance. Next up, we have the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus. This one has a 4.7-inch screen, but it is a 16:9 aspect ratio. So when showing 4x3 content, we're going to get a little bit less than 4 inches altogether. And so between the two, yes, the KTR1 is going to have a bigger screen size when it comes to 4x3 games. And thanks to the fact that the screen is not quite so wide, you are going to have a device that's a little bit thinner than the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus as well. And really where the RP 3 Plus is going to shine is when playing 16:9 content. That's going to give you that full 4.7 inches compared to the 4 1/3 that you're going to get on the KTR1. So if you do plan on playing a lot of PSP or maybe some game streaming, then I think the RP 3 Plus will be a better fit in that regard. Now, sticking with 16x9 systems, let's move up to 5 inches with the PS Vita. And once we get to this size, you can see that at 4x3 content, we are going to get about 4 inches altogether. So really, the screen image is going to be about the same between the two, but like with the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus, the PS Vita is wider than the KTR1. And then, of course, on the PS Vita, the bezels are going to be a lot larger, not only around the screen itself, but then also the pillar boxing you will naturally get from playing 4x3 content on a 16x9 screen. Okay, next up we have the Ambernic RG552. This one is unique because it's 5.5 inches, but with a 5x3 aspect ratio. And this is actually going to give us a larger size for 4x3 content, a little bit less than 4.5 inches. So if you are going to play 4x3 systems between the two right here, the 552 is going to be bigger. But of course, the size of the device is quite a bit larger than the KTR1 as well. And when it comes to Game Boy Advance, it'll be a similar story. We're going to get a little bit less than 5 inches on the RG552. Compared to the 4.5-inch screen on the KTR1. Now, one handheld that is a very good comparison with the KTR1 is going to be the Odin Lite. This is also an Android-based device that's around the same price as the KTR1, but it has a 6-inch screen, which is going to give us a little bit less than 5 inches when it comes to 4x3 content. But of course, you're looking at a device that is much larger than the KTR1. And really, there's a big difference between a 6-inch and a 4.5-inch display, as you can see. Especially when it comes to Game Boy Advance. For example, here on the Odin Lite, we're getting a little bit less than 5.5 inches compared to the 4.5 on the KTR1. So yes, overall, when you use a 6-inch screen like on the Odin, you will get a lot more screen real estate, but bear in mind, you're going to have a significantly larger device as well. To give you some bearings, the Odin Lite is a little bit larger than the Nintendo Switch Lite. In the end, if you're looking to play the best 4x3 content on the smallest device size possible, I think it's really going to come down to the KTR1 and the RG405M. These are both going to give you about 4 inches of 4x3 content, but as you can see, the RG405M is a much smaller form factor. Not only that, I prefer the buttons and the D-pad feel of the RG405M, but there are going to be some concessions. For example, the 405M is only available in metal, and personally I hope that they make a plastic version sometime in the future. Additionally, the chipset on the 405M is quite a bit weaker than the KTR1, which we'll do in some testing here later in the video. And then also bear in mind that the RG405M only has a 480p resolution display compared to the 1080p on the KTR1. And when it comes to retro gaming, that does make a difference. For example, when you scale a 4x3 game all the way up to the full 4 inches, when using a lower resolution display like the 405M, you can see that the pixels are not scaling correctly. The Mega Man life bar right here should be perfectly balanced. Now, if we look at the same scaling but on a 1080p display, you can see that they are much more balanced here. It's not quite perfect, but it is very, very close. Now, in my RG405M review, I did show a couple ways that you can balance the pixels. For example, you can use integer scaling. That's going to balance out everything perfectly, but it will make the screen a little bit smaller. So you will have more black borders around each side. And I think the size difference between the two is noticeable, as you can see. Another thing you can do is use special shaders to balance out those pixels. For the 405M, I've been using the Pixelate shader, which is available within RetroArch, and it works out great. In the end, I think that when playing 4x3 content between the two, it's going to work out just fine. It's really a matter of having to do a couple extra steps with the RG405M. Now I want to compare the screens of these four devices right here head on. And I think these are really good comparisons right here because they're all around the same price point of around $200, and they can give you pretty good performance all the way up through PSP upscale. So when looking at all four of these images, you can see that the color balance between them varies greatly. I would say the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus has a bit more of a red tint to it, and the KTR1 and Odin Lite are a little bit more on the green side. Honestly, among these four, I would say the 405M is probably the best balance between red and green, and it's also a little bit warmer of a tone as well. In addition to the color balance, another thing to factor in is going to be overall sharpness. Like I mentioned before, the RG405M is a 480p display, which means it's going to naturally play a lot of these higher-end 4x3 systems like Dreamcast and Nintendo 64 at a native resolution. And it does look very good and authentic, albeit a little bit chunky. If we look at something like the KTR1, we can play this at a 3x upscale thanks to that higher resolution. And so these 3D character sprites are going to look a lot sharper here. And when playing with an upscale like this, it kind of feels like you're playing a remastered version, which can look very nice. And the same can be done on the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus, but I would do this at a 2x resolution because this is only a 750p display. And I would say among the four, the most impressive is going to be the Odin Lite. This one also is a 1080p resolution, so we can do a 3x upscale. And because it's a larger size, you can just see everything a little bit more crisply here. In the end, I think that Dreamcast games like this are going to look great on any of these devices, but the three devices with the higher resolution are going to look a little bit sharper, whereas the RG405M is going to give you a more classic feel. Now, another thing you could do with some of these wider displays is use a widescreen hack. And so here I've applied it to the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus and the KTR1 and Odin Light. And as you can see, with the RP3 Plus and the Odin Light, they are filling out the full screen. It looks really good. However, when using a widescreen hack on the KTR1, it is going to force a 16:9 aspect ratio. So it will give you letterboxing on the top and bottom. Personally, I think I'd rather just use 4:3 and have a little bit of black bars on the left and right. And so in the end, it really comes down to how you want to play these classic systems. Would you rather play it with a widescreen hack and maybe an upscale to have a sharper texture? Or would you prefer a more classic 4:3 aspect ratio to give you that old school feel? Next up, let's do some weight testing. So we're looking at about 257 grams for the KTR1. And a lot of that weight is probably coming from that rather large battery. For example, you can see it's quite a bit heavier than the Retroid Pocket 2 Plus. And same thing with the PS Vita, the Ambernic RG353M, as well as the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus. Now, the RG405N being a metal device is about 10 grams heavier than the KTR1, and then it really just goes up from there. For example, the Ambernic RG505, then the RG552, and then finally the Odin Light is over 100 grams heavier than the KTR1. And just because it had to be done, here is the weight comparison with the Steam Deck with the Killswitch case installed. Overall, I think the KTR1 has a good weight and size to it if you are looking for something that's a little bit more portable and maybe even pocketable. If anything, it feels like a cell phone, but maybe a little bit thicker. For example, if you had like one of those cases that had a battery pack attached to it. Either way, yes, I think this device is pocketable if you are going to be walking around with something like shorts or with larger pockets. However, if you are wearing like tighter jeans, then it might be a little bit of an issue. But all the same, when it comes to devices that are around this size, this is easily the most powerful among them. So if you are looking for something that's as pocketable as possible with still giving you a good amount of power, this is probably going to be your best bet right now. Okay, moving over to software. Like I mentioned before, this is running an Android operating system. And this is an early test build of their Android software, and so there should be some updates coming out before the final retail release. Either way, as you can see here, it just functions a lot like an Android system. And no surprises here, I ended up using the Daijisho launcher as my front end to be able to get in and out of my games. I made a video about this launcher already, and it's one of my favorites I've been using for the past year or so. This is going to allow me to organize all my games, and then I can jump in and out of my emulators with one unified interface. So that's what I'll be using for the rest of this video here. Now, before we get into game testing, let's do a quick audio test. And honestly, I was excited to test this out just because it has front-firing speakers, which are always my favorite. So let's go ahead and give it a listen. Overall, I would say the audio quality here is well above average. Not only is it very crisp and clear, but it's very loud too. In fact, this is only about 75% volume in an untreated room. If I could make any complaint about these speakers is that it doesn't feel as bassy as I would like. But all the same, I'm very happy with the audio quality here overall. Okay, now let's start with the emulation testing. I'm going to start with the easier to play systems and then work my way up. As you can imagine, playing things like Game Boy and Game Boy Color are going to be absolutely fine here. And because of that 3:2 aspect ratio, I didn't find the pillar boxing on the left and right to be that bad at all. Moving over to home console systems, these old school ones are going to play just fine too. So everything from your 8-bit and 16-bit era, they're all going to play at full speed, and you can use like heavy duty shaders, stuff like that, no problem here. And I found this to be a very nice retro gaming experience. The colors are nice and vibrant, and I felt like the input delay between pressing the button and the actual action on the screen was very quick as well. Of course, this device is powerful enough to be able to turn on run ahead too, but I didn't really feel like I needed it. So yes, playing those old 4:3 home console systems all the way up through the 32-bit era, absolutely no problem here. But where the device really shines is going to be with Game Boy Advance. Number one, it's going to fully fill out that 3:2 aspect ratio screen and look beautiful. But on top of that, this device is so powerful that you can run fast forward at something like 700 frames per second. So if you want to breeze through your favorite role-playing or Pokemon game, you can do that right here. And of course, if you want to take your time and play these games in full speed at 60 frames per second, yeah, they're all going to play great. And this is easily the best looking of all the systems that you can play on the KTR1. Moving up from there, let's try out the PlayStation 1. Here I'm using the DuckStation emulator at a 3x resolution. Now, this is capable of doing a 5x upscale, which would give you 1080p, but I found that I did get a little bit of slowdown here and there at that resolution. And to be honest, I didn't really see a difference between 3x and 5x from my naked eye. So my recommendation here would be to try out 3x resolution with the PS1 and see if you like it. I also think that playing it at a lower resolution like this is going to save on battery life too, because it's not going to push the CPU so hard. Moving over from there, let's try out Nintendo DS here with the Drastic emulator. And this one's working great too. I've assigned the L2 and R2 hotkeys to be able to swap the screens. And because this has a touchscreen, you can use that for the bottom screen of the DS if you'd like as well. So as long as you don't mind swapping between the two screens on Nintendo DS, you should have a good time here. I got quite a few requests when it came to arcade games, so let's test out those ones next. And when it comes to those classic arcade games, everything up through like the mid-90s, those are all going to play just fine. Even when trying a little bit harder of an engine like with NBA Hangtime. And I also found that Killer Instinct was just at the cusp of playing at full speed. It would dip down to 59, sometimes 58 frames per second here and there, and I would hear an audio stutter from time to time. But if those things don't bother you, I think it's going to be really great to play Killer Instinct on this device. But I did find that the upper limit was about Killer Instinct 2. This would give me about 56 to 58 frames per second on average, and you are going to feel that slowdown while in-game. I also found that playing arcade games in a vertically oriented Tate mode worked out really well too. For this, you have to go into the settings and swap everything over, and then also map the D-pad to the right analog stick, and then rotate each of the cardinal directions. After you've done that remapping, it's actually a pretty nice experience to play it vertically like this. I found the device to be just short enough that it wasn't too cumbersome to hold it like this with my medium-sized hands. So let's go ahead and move up to some of the harder-to-emulate systems. We're going to start with Nintendo 64 first. This one I'm upscaling to a 1080p resolution and every single game played at full speed. So if you're looking for something to play Nintendo 64, this will be a great fit. And just like when playing with the arcade systems, having the joystick on top like this is a really nice experience for me. And I found it to be similar with the Dreamcast as well. For these games, I upscaled them to a 960p within the ReDream emulator, because the next step up from there is 1440p, and that's just a little bit too much for this hardware here. However, at 960p, these games look great, and all of them are going to play at full speed. And because many of them primarily use a joystick for control, this is going to be a nice setup here with the analog stick up top. Okay, up next we have the PlayStation Portable, and here I did have to fiddle around with the settings from time to time. For example, some of the lightweight games like Virtua Tennis can play at a 4x resolution, which is essentially 1080p. However, once you get to some games that are a little bit more taxing, I found that a 3x resolution is going to work best. And so for games like Ridge Racer and Outrun 2006, this seemed to be the best balance right here. I did get a little bit of slowdown here and there when I was transitioning from 30 to 60 frames in Outrun 2006, so if that segment bothers you, then you may have to drop it down to a 2x resolution. Other games will basically require a 2x resolution in order to play smoothly. I found that to be the case with games like Tekken 6, as well as God of War Chains of Olympus. So for the most part, I would say that PSP is going to be 100% playable here, and at least at a 2x resolution or beyond. You are going to get a little bit of letterboxing on top and bottom because this is a 16:9 system, but all the same, because it's a 4.5-inch screen, I think it's still a pretty good size. Now from here, we're going to move on to these systems that don't play 100% every single time. And before we get to that, I want to do a quick baseline when it comes to synthetic benchmarks. So for the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus, the KTR1, and the Odin Light, I ran the wildlife stress test here in Android. This is a 20-minute test right here that gives you an idea of how games are going to run on an Android device. And there's a couple takeaways here from the top part of the screen. Number one, you can see that this score on the KTR1 is basically sandwiched between the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus as well as the Odin Light. And that's about what I expected given the chipset that we're running right here. I also was surprised to find that all three of these devices have very good stability. This means that over a 20-minute period, we didn't have dips in performance due to overheating. And between these three, only the Odin Light has active cooling with a fan. Now, if we go to the bottom half of the testing screen, there's a couple other things we can see. Number one, you can see that the KTR1 lost the least amount of battery life overall. After being taxed for 20 minutes straight, it lost 4% battery compared to the 9% on the Odin Light, as well as the 6% on the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus. And the fact that the KTR1 has the largest battery among them probably has something to do with this figure as well. I also found that the temperatures remained relatively cool between all three devices, as you can see. So let's go ahead and move on to the systems that do have trouble performing at full speed. To start, we have Sega Saturn. Now this one was a little bit funky. For example, I couldn't play the Yabusan Shiro standalone core. Anytime I tried to open up a game, either with the OpenGL or Vulkan backend, it just gave me a blank screen. And so I had to stick with RetroArch, and my favorite RetroArch core is the Beetle core because it's very accurate, but I found that that one was way too slow. Instead, I ended up using the Yabusan Shiro core within RetroArch. And honestly, this one does a pretty good job. I think that most games are going to play at full speed. But I did find that those games at the upper tier, for example Panzer Dragoon or Sega Rally Championship, did have some slowdown from time to time. So in the end, I'm not comfortable saying that every Saturn game is going to play at full speed on the KTR1, but the majority of them will, and they will play better than the T618 devices like the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus or the RG405M. Another system a lot of people asked about when it came to the KTR1 was how it was going to play with GameCube. After all, my opinion on the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus and similar devices is that they are not capable of full-speed GameCube. If anything, I tell people to treat it like an added bonus. And unfortunately, it's a very similar story with the KTR1. I know a lot of people are probably hoping for some really good GameCube gameplay, but I found that all the same tricks I have to do with the T618 devices, I have to do with the KTR1 as well. So that means you will have to juggle between the various emulator options that you have, and you're probably going to have to swap between PAL and NTSC ROM so that you can get the 50Hz gameplay when needed. Now, all told, I did find that I got better performance with the KTR1 than those other devices, but you're definitely going to have to work for it, and I found that the Dolphin MMJR app was the consistently best app to use. And so for the majority of my gameplay footage, you are going to see that I'm using that app here. And I did find that many games that don't play at full speed with the T618 devices do play at full speed here. So for example, Burnout 2, even with the NTSC ROM, works fine, and same thing with 007 Nightfire. It's not perfect, you're going to get some slowdown here and there, but overall it's still a pretty good gameplay experience. Now some other favorites I think are still just barely out of grasp on this chipset. For example, Metroid Prime has some noticeable slowdown and stuttering, and same thing with Resident Evil 4, especially in the larger scenes with lots of enemies, you will get some slowdown here and there. But personally, I think I'd be able to play through Resident Evil 4 at this speed right here. Other games like Legend of Zelda Wind Waker will play pretty well in most scenes, but when you get into like the open ocean or you're approaching a large island, you'll definitely get some slowdown. When it comes to GameCube, I think my best summary here is the fact that you can play certain games if you tweak the settings enough, and a good example here is going to be F-Zero GX. I spent about 20 minutes messing around with the settings and finding the right balance right here, which is with the Vulkan backend at a 300% CPU speed. And bear in mind, we had to use the PAL ROM to get up to the 50 frames per second. And here, for the most part, I would say that the game is relatively playable. Now, if you're an F-Zero GX snob, you're probably not going to like this, but if you don't mind a slowdown here and there, you should be able to play most tracks. As comparison, here is the NTSC version of this game running with the same settings in Dolphin MMJR, but on the Odin Light. And here, it's running at 60 frames per second, and I'm getting basically no slowdown whatsoever. And so while the KTR1 does a pretty admirable job when it comes to playing most GameCube games, to me it's very apparent that the Odin Light has a leg up in this regard. Now, moving things up, we're going to try Nintendo Wii, and this one unfortunately had worse results than with GameCube. For example, I could get Donkey Kong Country Returns to play at a relatively fast speed, but it does present some graphical anomalies like the black box you can see flickering on the top left. Now, Kirby's Epic Yarn did play at relatively good speed, in fact I would find this to be playable, and if you mess around with the settings enough in Super Mario Galaxy, you can get it relatively fast too. But just bear in mind, you have to turn on the Skip EFB hack in order to get it to play like this, and when you do that, you're going to have issues with the cursor. It's not going to pick up any of those star points, and also you're not going to be able to go through any of those star portals either. So you'll have to toggle between those two settings when you get to certain parts in each game. And depending on how you feel about that, it might turn into a bit of a chore. And I think showing New Super Mario Bros. Wii is a great example here. Using the Dolphin MMJR app, I got some pretty good sound, but the game itself played at what felt like about 75% speed. And it was even worse on the MMJR2 build. Here I also had about 75% speed, but the sound was very stuttery too. And surprisingly, the best experience I had here was with the official Dolphin app, which generally ran slower with all the other GameCube and Wii games. But this one, when I turned on the VBI skip hack, it actually played at about maybe 90% speed. So still not quite a perfect emulation experience, but pretty close. And whether or not you determine that to be playable is really going to be up to you. For me personally, I think I'd rather wait and play Nintendo Wii on a more capable handheld. Moving over to Nintendo 3DS, I also got a mixed experience. Some games like Metroid Samus Returns had very little slowdown, in fact I would call this one playable. But I found with a lot of other games, I was experiencing a lot of graphical issues. With New Super Mario Bros. 2, using the Citra MMJ build, I was getting some stutters as you can see here. The game itself was playing at full speed, but I would get stuck in these areas and it just wasn't very fun. At first I thought it had to do with shaders caching, but over time it didn't get any better. And so I swapped it out to the official Canary build, and even here I had the same issue. And on top of that, the game ran a lot slower here. So not only was it unplayably slow, but then I was getting those same juddery issues. And so this leads me to believe it's probably a compatibility issue with that specific chipset that we have right here. And so this may be something that does get improved over time, but at least for now in my testing with both of the two Citra builds, I found that the majority of the games had graphical issues like this. Okay, next up we're going to do PlayStation 2 emulation using AetherSX 2. And the experience here is going to be very similar to how it was on the GameCube. So there are many games that will play at full speed, but you will have to do some adjustments here and there. For example, you may have to use the PAL version of some of these ROMs to get them to play at a full 50 frames per second. But you will find other games, for example Bloody Roar 3 or Tekken 5 or even Simpsons Hit and Run, that will play at relatively full speed with the NTSC ROM. But I think just to be safe, your best bet here is probably going to be to stick with the PAL ROMs unless you're proven otherwise. Regardless, like with the GameCube, I did find that some games here played better than they did on the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus or the RG405M. For example, the first Dark Cloud is a game that I don't find to be playable on those other two systems, but it seems to be pretty good right here on the KTR1. And of course, as you start to move up, you will find a lot of slowdown. For example, Tony Hawk's Underground 2 would yin-yang between like full speed and then really slow speed, like half speed. And so this is one that I would say is probably not going to be playable in most use cases. For other games, you're going to have to start messing around with the underclocking settings. Some games like Gauntlet Dark Legacy will play a little bit better with a mild underclock to the point where it's basically playable. But others, like Burnout Revenge, even if you give it a moderate underclock, will still have a lot of slowdown here and there. Other games like Jak 3 are basically unplayable. Regardless of the graphical backend, you're going to get a lot of slowdown right here, and giving it an underclock seems to make no difference when it comes to the game speed either. However, some games, like God of War 2, when you apply a moderate underclock, will play at basically full speed, but it is going to do a bunch of frame skipping, so it's going to have a bit of a jerkier experience overall. Whether or not you find this to be playable, or you want to try it out on a different system, is really going to be up to you. In the end, I would say, at least in my testing right here, the KTR1 is not going to be capable of playing every PS2 game. And finally, the last emulated system I wanted to test is the Nintendo Switch using the Skyline emulator. When it comes to these lightweight games like Sonic Mania or SteamWorld Dig 2, yeah, it worked out pretty well. I was also surprised to find that a little bit heavier weight games like Shredder's Revenge did play at full speed too. However, after that, when you get into the games that are a little bit larger, those that are like a gig or larger in file size, you are going to run into issues. There was a lot of skipping happening in Metroid Dread, and so I wouldn't consider this one to be playable, especially when you consider the fact that timing in some of your moves is really important in this game. And I had a similar experience with Cuphead. I would get a lot of slowdown and stuttering in the beginning of levels, and it still kind of persisted throughout. And for a game as difficult as this, I think that would be a really frustrating experience. And that's really about it when it comes to Switch. You're not going to be able to play anything more heavier weight than this. Now, I mostly focused on retro game emulation because that seemed to be what most people were interested in, but I also did test it with Android gaming and streaming too. I only tried a couple Android games, but these played just fine. However, game streaming was a different experience. And I should note that with my test build right here, it didn't have a Wi-Fi antenna installed in the device, but this is something that'll definitely be in the retail build. All the same, I found I needed to be in the exact same room as my router just to get a Wi-Fi signal. And so that's why I'm playing here at my studio desk instead of my typical green background. Either way, when I was close to a router, yeah, the connection actually was pretty stable. But I did find that the key coding had some issues. For example, L2 and R2 did not register when playing Xbox Game Pass. And so as nice as the streaming connection was right here, the game was still unplayable. And this is a pretty common issue that happens with a lot of retro handhelds, and so hopefully they can fix this one in the software later on. And my other observation here was that even if it did have the L2 and R2 working, this wouldn't be a very comfortable gaming experience anyway. This is one of those times when having stacked shoulder buttons really comes into play. And so if you are thinking about game streaming, I would recommend something like the Odin Light or even the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus. And I would recommend the Odin Light over those others just because this one has analog trigger inputs, and it also has a Wi-Fi 6E chip inside, so you're going to get an even more stable connection as well. So in the end, I wouldn't recommend the KTR1 from a streaming perspective, not only from the ergonomics, but then also from the key coding issues that I'm seeing right now. Alright, we've been at this for a while, and so let's go ahead and start wrapping things up by talking about what I like and what I don't like about the KTR1. As always, we'll start with what I like, and number one is the display. I love the fact that we have a 3:2 aspect ratio screen in a larger handheld. This aspect ratio combined with the 4.5-inch screen and the 1080p resolution is really a sight to behold. So if you're looking for a jack of all trades when it comes to screens, then I think this one is one of the best that you can choose. I also love the fact that the KTR1 is a customizable handheld. This is the first one I've ever seen where you can choose where you want the D-pad to be placed. And given the fact that this is an ongoing debate within the community, I think this solves that problem right here. I also love the fact that we have a plastic and metal option right out of the box. Additionally, I think that the audio quality here is way above average compared to other handhelds. I love the fact that these speakers are front-firing and they are nice and crisp and loud. In terms of portability, I think that the KTR1 is just at the cusp of being pocketable. If you have larger pockets, I think you're going to be able to slide it in and out, no problem. I also love the DIY or boutique experience of the KTR1. I love that this device has basically been created from start to finish by just one person, and so it feels like a little bit more intimate of a purchase compared to other handhelds. And finally, I really enjoy the battery life on the KTR1. This is one of those devices where I don't feel like I need to charge it every day. And honestly, in the world of retro handhelds, that's a pretty rare feat. Now, of course, this handheld is not perfect, and so let's talk about some of the things I don't like about the one that I tested. Number one is the build quality. Now, this could change with the retail unit, and so I don't want to grade this one too harshly because it is a test unit. But all the same, I don't want to overpromise that things are going to get better when they may not. To summarize, I think the build quality here definitely feels like it's handmade. If anything, I would say that it reminds me a bit of some of those cheaper Pal Kitty handhelds. We've got some shoulder buttons that rattle, and just everything feels a little bit creaky too. And hopefully I'll get my hands on a retail unit in the future to see if my concerns are warranted. But at least for now, I felt like I needed to at least speak about that from my own experience. Additionally, I didn't like the button feel of the face buttons in particular. The buttons themselves were seated a little bit too low, and I think that they bottom out too quickly. Not only that, I feel like the rubber membranes, both on the D-pad and the face buttons, are just a little bit too stiff. Another thing that really kind of bothered me about this device was the placement of that home button. I really can't even count how many times I accidentally pressed it, either inadvertently or trying to press the start button, and I would be backed out of my game and lose my save altogether. On some emulators, like the PS2 and GameCube emulators, it's no big deal, you can jump right back into the game. But on RetroArch, which I played for the majority of my testing, that can have catastrophic consequences. So if I was king for a day, I would place the home button in a different position than where it is right here. I'm also a little bit disappointed that there is no video out. I think that when you're paying about $200 for a handheld, it should come standard. And then finally, I don't think that this is going to be the huge leap in performance that a lot of people were hoping for. Yes, it definitely does play better than the T618 devices like the Retroid Pocket 3 Plus and the RG405M, but if anything, it just gives you a higher percentage of GameCube and PS2 games that you can play. It's definitely not at that tipping point where I can say that yes, all those systems are completely playable. Altogether, I found that the KTR1 shined the best when it was playing retro games, especially Game Boy Advance games thanks to that 3x2 aspect ratio. And of course, all the other retro systems, all the way up to PSP, play great too, especially when you can upscale some of those 3D systems. However, when it comes to Saturn and beyond, you are going to have to fiddle around with the settings in order to get better performance. And even then, no matter how much tweaking you do, I don't think you're going to be able to play 100% of those catalogs. Okay, so in wrapping things up here, you're probably wondering whether or not I recommend the KTR1 as a handheld gaming device. And honestly, I'm a little bit torn about this, probably way more than I am usually with my reviews. Number one, I love the fact that this thing was created in the first place. After all, this is really just the work of one person putting things together to try to help out the community. And in many ways, this thing is a huge success. It can play so many different games, it has a beautiful screen, and the amount of customizability is pretty awesome. However, there's a limit to how awesome this thing is. Number one is the build quality, like I mentioned before, and honestly, that can be a good or a bad thing depending on the handheld experience that you want. When it comes to the overall price, I think that this can go pound for pound with many other handhelds. At the very cheapest, you can get it for under $200, but even then, if you want to spend up to $300, you can get a lot of bells and whistles. But one of the things I've noticed over the years is that this handheld has been placed on a pedestal by the retro handheld community. I think there's a lot of enthusiasm out there, and some of it is warranted, but some of it might have gotten a little bit carried away. In the end, if you're looking for a decent handheld that does have some compromises, I think the KTR1 is a great choice. If you're the kind of person who doesn't mind getting into the settings and doing some tinkering, or maybe going onto Discord and Reddit and finding the best use case scenarios for each game, then I think that yes, the KTR1 is going to be a lot of fun. However, I would not say that this handheld is the end-all be-all to retro game emulation. When it comes down to it, we have a decent chip with a very excellent screen inside of a somewhat mediocre shell and at a very good price. And really, 3 out of 4 is not bad. And so if you are thinking about picking one of these up and you do understand its shortcomings, then yes, I think the KTR1 can be recommended. However, if you're looking at getting your very first handheld and you've heard a lot of good things on Reddit and Discord about this one, I would say that you may need to temper your expectations. For example, this device has had a bunch of delays over the past couple years, which is expected with a one-person team. So if you do make an order, I would expect a fairly lengthy wait as things kind of get worked out. But in the meantime, you could try one of the many other handhelds that I featured in this video, and you could have them here within a week or two. And yes, you may end up paying a little bit more for one of those, or maybe you'll get less performance or a smaller screen or a larger screen. Again, these are all factors you kind of have to consider. My point in all this is that yes, if you know what you're getting into, the KTR1 is a good bet. But I don't think it's going to be the end-all be-all that many people hoped. All the same, it's a great little handheld, and if you're looking to spend around $200 to $300 to have something that's very unique, then this is going to be the handheld for you. But for everybody else, I would think about paying just a little bit more for the Odin Light and getting a lot more performance, or a little bit less for the Retroid Pocket 3 or the Amberneck RG405M to get a little bit less performance, but have it right now with some really great build quality. In the end, I enjoyed the 2 weeks that I tested the KTR1, but after all is said and done, when I'm finished with this video, I'm probably going to go back to my RG405M for most of the games that I was playing on this anyway. I think we're all still waiting on that one handheld that can play everything GameCube and PS2, and I found myself fiddling way too much in the settings to really enjoy myself with this one. Instead, I'm just going to focus on the other 4x3 systems that I love to play, and for those, the RG405M does a really great job, and is much smaller and more compact too. Anyway, I could ramble about these things all day. I hope you enjoyed this video, and be sure to like and subscribe if you found it helpful. And we will see you next time. Happy gaming.